And now, an 8 original production.
Super Simple with Terri O is made possible by
Goodwill of Central Arizona uses retail store revenue to support the community with employment and human services programs that train and prepare individuals for work and finding jobs. Good stuff, good work, Goodwill. Information at goodwillaz.org.
To Fix It is a Valley-based referral service providing a resource for pre-screened, hand-selected companies who are chosen from hundreds of companies. We recommend the best and toss the rest. Information at tofixit.com or 602-TO-FIX-IT.
Gilbert Ortega Galleries features authentic, handmade Native American art, jewelry, and crafts. Fifth-generation family-owned and operated. Locations in Old Town Scottsdale and Fifth Avenue. Experience what we have spent a lifetime learning.
Hey there, Terri O here. Coming up on today's show, if your hands are always cold, I'll show you how to keep them warm and make them look hot.
Plus, if you have a four-legged friend who leaves a mess behind at dinner time, I'll show you how to make a cute little placemat. And looking for something new to grill? How about a pizza?
But first, I'll show you the tools you need to make yourself look beautiful every morning. These, my friends, are the tools you need in order to create a beautiful face. They are the basics. They are must-haves. I always talk about having the right tools, whether it's crafting or cooking. Well, you know what? When creating a beautiful face, you gotta have the right tools. And I have the right tool right here. She is a makeup artist, a cosmetic expert. She works at the Cos Bar. And I'm telling you, Gloria, you really know your stuff. So I appreciate you showing us what we need in order to create a beautiful face. And these are the basic tools.
Absolutely.
All right, let's talk about them. They're beautiful brushes. What are they made of?
They're actually the blush brush and your shadow and your double-ended blush brush is made of sable.
Ooh.
And it's nice. All these brushes, they're hand-tied, hand-cut, so you have that nice, perfect finished look on your face.
So let me just point this out to everyone, because if you're going to go out and buy cosmetic brushes, you're making an investment.
Exactly.
So buy good,
good ones.
Good brushes.
They'll last forever.
And how long have you had your brushes?
4 years.
Okay, I've had mine a lot longer. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you something. It is worth every single penny. So let's start with the basic five brushes.
Okay.
This one first.
Your first one here is it's an angled foundation brush. What's nice about this brush and your concealer brush, they are both the top high-end synthetic nylon. So when using this, I don't know if you've ever had foundation brushes that actually would leave like little streaks on your face when you're doing your foundation.
Mm-hmm.
What's nice, this is cut. So when you apply, you can go down, always go downward when you do your foundation. If you're using a liquid, when you do use a liquid, make sure you put a little bit in the back of your hand and then just go on and then start blending down, because your facial hairs grow downward. Mm-hmm. So you're going to get more of a flawless finish.
What facial hairs?
You never know.
Okay.
And then what's nice about this too, it actually goes into the corners too. So it's an excellent brush the way it is cut in the angle.
Okay. So getting in all of the nooks and crannies,
mm-hmm.
Here is what we're calling your foundation brush, angled and flat.
Right.
Okay. Good to know. Here's your second brush, and this is a concealer brush.
This is your concealer brush.
And point out the differences of this brush.
Okay. This one here, again, is the top of the line synthetic nylon, but as you can see how it's kind of cut to the side to the point. So this will get real close to inside the eye area. So when you apply your concealer, again, it's a little bit in the dot,
mm-hmm.
and then right here, and you're patting it in.
You're not brushing, you're patting.
No, you're patting it in. Because you don't want to, your eye area is very delicate, so you mm-hmm. don't want to pull or stretch.
Okay.
So you just want to gently go through here. Again, you can go through the nose area, wherever it's closer to, you want to get a nice smoothness to the look of the skin.
All right, and here's the third brush, another very important brush. This is your powder brush.
This is your powder brush.
And tell us about this brush here.
This one here.
What are we looking for when we buy one?
You want to get a nice powder brush that's kind of poof. It has a lot of fullness to it. You don't want too big. But you want a nice to where it just covers the whole face, real
okay.
simple.
Okay.
So what's nice, again, this is, as you can see, kind of cut nicely, even if the hair is a sable. And if you're going to do your powder, you know, you just tap it to loosen it up,
mm-hmm.
and then you just gently just dust all over the face. And okay. You can even bring it down to the neckline if you wanted to, but you just gently just dust it all.
Okay, this is a must, a mm-hmm. must. Actually, they're all a must as far as I'm concerned. Okay, our fourth brush, this is our shadow brush.
Yes.
And what is so special about this particular, the shape of this one?
This one is nice because it fits right into the eyelid.
Okay.
So if you close your eyes, as you can see the brush, you just apply it and it goes right in. Mm-hmm. It's with one sweep. It is so nice. And what's nice about these brushes too, Terri, is the pigmentation of the powders that you grab, it goes on there beautifully. You don't have to constantly reapply. It just does in one nice sweep.
Okay, that's important.
That's important.
And an inexpensive brush won't hold on to the shadow, and that's why you get all that stuff on your cheeks afterwards,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
you have a mess. Okay, last but not least, this is our final brush, and here's what's really cool about this one. Look at this. There's the top portion of it, which is nice and full, and then the bottom, which is short and flat, and this is our blush brush.
Mm-hmm.
And why is it double-ended?
Well, this is every woman's favorite because it's, the reason it's double-ended because you got the blush where you can apply here and then you got the contouring. So if you made a mistake, you just circularly blend or doing, if you want to make the cheekbones look higher, you can take your bronzer, go in there just to contour a little bit more or on the top, but it's nice because it's double-ended.
Excellent.
It's real simple.
All right. That's what we love. Real simple. All right. Here you go. One more time. The five must-haves for you to be beautiful, the super simple way. Thanks, Gloria.
Thank you.
Here's a quick tip to clean your makeup brushes, which is really important to do. First, take your makeup brush and wet it in the water. Add a little bit of baby shampoo to your hand. Just a little, and swish, ooh, look at that, swish your brush in your hand gently, don't push too hard, and rinse. Squeeze out the excess water, don't pull your bristles down, just squeeze. Shake out the excess water and lay it on a paper towel to dry. Till next time.
Well, I want you to meet the newest member of the Terri O family. This is Nikki, better known as Nickerdoodle. She's a little Shih Tzu, and she is our new baby in the family. And you know what? Because she's a baby, she is a messy, messy eater. But I have a solution to that problem, and I think you might like it too. If you have a lovely little pet like this at your house, I'm going to create a little doggy mat. So let me hand off little Knickers, and I'm going to show you how I'm going to make this adorable mat. Okay, here are the supplies that you're going to need. First of all, you can go to a carpet store or a home improvement store, and you can purchase or ask for remnants. These are samples. They come in different sizes. This is a fairly large one, but I like it large. And they come in different colors and different textures. I try to find something a little bit smooth to work with. I'm going to make some of my own stamps because I want to make little bones and little doggy impressions with the little footprints. So I'm going to show you how to do that. Of course, scissors, a pencil. I have some stamps here that I purchased. Letters, and I want to create some wording on it, maybe the puppy's name or whatever. So here's what I want to do. I'm going to start with some paint, and I like to use a paper plate as a palette because you can throw it away when it's done. So I'm going to use black paint, and I'm going to put a little bit out on my paint palette here, not too much. And I like to use a sponge brush because, well, I can clean them out or I can just throw them away. I actually do repurpose them quite often, but if I choose to throw it away, then I can. And this is a really nice sponge brush, by the way. I like these sponge brushes. Okay, so, and paper towels. Don't forget about paper towels. So I'm going to put this off to the side for just a second, and I want to show you how to make your own stamp. So Now, if you don't feel comfortable drawing something out, then, you know, you can print something off the internet or whatever, but you just want to get some thick craft foam like I have here. This is really super thick foam, and this is important. You want this kind of thick foam. And I'm just going to maybe draw out, you know, the shape of a bone, which I already did, and I already cut mine out. Okay? I mean, maybe that's, I don't know, whatever. That's a pretty good bone, okay? Anyway, I already did mine, and here it is, and I've already used it. Once you draw that shape out, then you cut it out with your scissors, which I've done here. Then what you want to do is you want to start building up something to hold your stamp with, which I've started to do right here. And what I basically do are, I use some of the leftover pieces here. So because I don't have any sitting here, I'm going to cut off a piece. Just like this, and with my glue gun, I'm just going to add another handle to this. And the reason why you do this is because you need something to grip onto when you're stamping. For example, this stamp right here, this isn't thick enough. Well, actually it is, but you know what, just to be safe, I'm going to go ahead and add one more piece to it just so that I can, again, have something to grab onto. Because if you don't, what happens is you get the tips of your fingers in the paint, and then when you go to press your stamp down, you just kind of ruined your impression. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. So there you go. So now I have a nice, thick stamp to work with. And this one right here, this is how I did the little paw print. I just made one big circle and then three little circles for the paws. Glue them on just like that, and try to make it so that there's a separation in between each paw and the paw pad there. Okay, so there we go. Now I have my cute little doggy stamps. And of course you can buy doggy stamps at the store, but why when you can make them? Okay, so now I'm going to go ahead and print or stamp my doggy bone down here in the corner. And I like to, as opposed to putting my stamp in the paint, I prefer to paint the paint onto my stamp. I don't know, it's just better that way, especially when you're using the letters, because then too much paint gets on there and then it gets in between and it makes a big blob, and you just don't want that. And because this carpeting is textured, I'm going to go ahead and stamp right here in the corner with this little doggy bone. And because the carpeting's textured, it actually, you know, it's not going to be a perfect impression. And if you want a perfect impression, then, you know, you might want to stamp it twice. Okay. Ooh, I love this. Okay, see, it's not real dark. I actually went in and did that one twice, so I'm going to do this one twice too. You can just go right over it again. And if you want it super dark, go back in with a paintbrush and fill it in, which is really easy to do. So what I'm going to do with the paw print is, you know, I want it to look like, you know, the puppy. This would be a very big puppy, by the way, walked across the mat. So I don't really care where it goes. So I'm going to go like here, here, here. Oh my gosh, how cute is that? I want that one just a little bit darker. Is this not the cutest darn thing you've ever seen? I love this. Okay, now I'm going to do the lettering. And instead of spelling out her name, I'm going to spell out Bow Wow. And I'm going to do this upside down, in case you didn't notice. Okay, so once again, I'm going to take my sponge brush, sponge my letters. And I think I want Bow Wow to kind of go kind of across the top right here. So start with the B. Give me a B.
B.
B. Got it. Give me an O.
O.
Got it.
Give me a W.
W.
Oh, okay. Got it. Give me another W.
W.
Excellent. Different O. Is it different shaped O's? Oh, give me an O.
O.
Okay, thank you. Whew, almost messed that one up. And then one more W. Give me a W.
W.
Okay. Oh my gosh, you guys. Woohoo. Look at this. How adorable is that? Now, because it's acrylic paint, when it dries, it's washable. So if there's, you know, some major spills on this little rug, I can clean them up and the paint won't come off because it is an acrylic paint. Okay? So now my little knickerdoodle won't get snickerdoodle all over my nice floor. All right, well, when it comes to cooking super simple, there's nothing more super simple than dialing for pizza, right?
That is true.
But yes. If you want to make your own pizza, think about this. Chef Peyton Curry, you're going to show us how to grill pizza, which I love. And we're going to start with something super simple like this. You can buy it at the grocery store.
Yes, you can. Just a simple, simple thin pizza crust. You have to make sure that it is thin for this application.
Okay.
So what we're going to do, it's kind of like a Tuscan flatbread kind of situation here. So we just rolled out the dough and just a touch of flour. And then we're also going to give it a little bit of olive oil. Not a lot. There's no red sauce on this pizza whatsoever. Just olive oil. If you could open the grill, that'd be great.
And we've got this
hot.
Hot.
For sure.
We have asparagus on there.
That's okay. We'll use this in our pizza.
Man, you've got chef hands.
I do. Chef driven, of course. So we're just going to grill one side. It's going to come up fast. You see the bubbles coming?
Yes.
So then you just take it. Obviously, you'd use tongs. I use my hands. So literally, maybe a minute at the most, right?
Okay.
We're going to do both sides. So again, hot grill on this side, a lower grill here. We're going to turn it down. Once we get it nice and crisp, all we're trying to do right now is par-bake the dough, right? So it doesn't get soggy. We're going to bring it back up on the cutting board now. Once it gets the nice grill on it. Now, what you can do now is if you have a salad or a wrap that you want to do, definitely, you know, you have a little romaine or you have some of your favorite lettuce greens, definitely go into that.
Mm-hmm.
So we added chicken, a little bit of green onions.
Which we grilled.
Some grilled corn.
Which we grilled.
And some canned beans, which you did not grill.
Which I opened.
Which you opened, yes. This is a little cotija cheese.
Oh, yeah, I like that.
Which we're going to mix into that as well. And then just a touch of olive oil. So here, if you wanted to add some oregano or you wanted to add some margarine, some lime zest, whatever you want to do.
What about one of our spice mixes?
Spice mix for sure. On this one, I would probably use the blackened spice.
And that one was for the
It was for
chicken?
The beef.
Oh.
For the beef. You study your notes. So we're going to just spread this out on the flatbread. Now, if you wanted to from here, you can throw this into a pan. If you want to, and then throw it back on the grill.
All right. What we're going to do is...
Open.
Put it back on the grill?
We are.
Okay.
Everything is shut off.
Really?
Yes.
Completely?
Completely off.
Okay.
Shut it off. This is on the cold side, or the cooler side. Now we're going to shut our grill and clean up.
Well, I'll just wait.
Now we cleaned up. So that was easy. We'll grab a pizza cutter or a knife. Which we have.
I'll just move that.
Some shrapnel. We're going to give this about 3 or 4 minutes.
Can I look?
No, you cannot look. I was just going to say that. People have the tendency to open the grill to look. What you're waiting for now, we're baking. We're not grilling now. We're baking because it's shut.
It's off.
It's off and the grill lid is shut.
Right.
So those of you at home that want to grill with the lid down, you're baking. So that's fine. You're baking on the grill. So in the summer, it's nice. You can do brownies on the grill. You can do whatever you want.
So if you close the grill, that doesn't mean you're cooking any faster.
No. It holds in the heat differently, but a grill, you want that one side heat coming up so it caramelizes the bottom.
Oh, okay.
The minute you shut it, it's all around heat.
Okay.
So we'll
just wait.
4, 3, 2, 1, open it. Let's go.
Really? Are
yep.
you sure?
I'm positive. So now we opened it. We can look at our crust. The crust is nice and brown. Again, You can let this go for a few more minutes if you want to, but what I like to do in this situation, instead of just doing it with for pizza,
oh
I do a little wrap.
Look at you.
Of course, it is a little hot.
Oh my gosh, I don't know how to do that.
And then I'll let this sit.
Okay.
So I'll let it sit.
Should I get a plate?
If you want to get a plate, that'd be great.
Oh, yeah.
So if you have any sort of mixed greens or anything you want to use, you can do that. But I like to do a little wrap here. Instead of paying $8, $9, you did about $6.
Voila.
Voila. Yes.
Okay, so pretty much this is what it looks like.
Yeah.
And you can put anything in there, right?
Anything you want.
All right, I'm going to take a bite.
Yeah, it's great. It's simple. It's different than a pizza. It's a flatbread. Mm. You can use that same dough as a pita bread if you want to. Just leave it a little bit thicker on the grill, you know, with some yogurt and cucumbers and mint and red onion. You're good to go.
That is really good.
So nice and simple. Again, careful when you take it off the heat if you don't have kitchen hands. It is a little hot. But if you want to, pull it off the grill, throw it in one of your jelly roll cake pans, and then you can roll it like that, too.
Excellent. So it is really a grilled flatbread rolled pizza.
Of course, which is four sentences long, but it's the same thing as
same
pizza.
Same thing. It's super simple. That's all that matters.
It is. That is true. Unless you try to say it. Yes.
Thanks, Jeff.
You're welcome, love.
What? My lovely mittens? Aren't they spectacular? I love them. Look at how cute these are. And I have to tell you something. I paid a buck for these mittens. Yeah. And all I did was add a little bling. And you can do the same thing. But let me show you where I got my inspiration. Okay, I saw it in a magazine. Now, you know what? Isn't that most of, you know, the places we get our inspiration from? I love, love, love this idea. So here's what I did. I picked up some iron-ons and some jewels and some inexpensive gloves and hats and bands and things like that. And all I did was iron on a design, and then I stitched a few, I stitched a few of the jewels onto the mittens. Now, you don't have to do that. You can do as little or as much as you want to do, but let me just give you a few little tips on how to do this successfully. Okay, what you want to do is you want to lay your mittens down flat, and you want to work on a surface that's heat resistant. So one thing that you want to do is make sure before you iron on anything that you have the backs of your mittens up. Yeah, I've made that mistake. I got all excited and then, you know, put one design on the inside and one design on the outside. So there you go. Okay, so I have my mittens backside up. And that's how you test that out. So what you want to do then is, because these are really stretchy, I just took a piece of kind of heavy cardboard cardstock, and I put it on the inside of the glove. And that way it just kind of, it doesn't stretch it all the way out, but it does put a little bit of a stretch on your glove. So that when you iron on your design and it stretches for the first time, things don't go ping-pong all over the place. So I'm using an iron-on design that I found that I liked. You can use anything that you like. I would only suggest, depending on what manufacturer you're using, that you follow their instructions on how to iron on and what to iron on and what heat setting to use. So I'm just going to put my design here, move that up a little bit, on my glove. And I have this handy-dandy, cutie-patootie little iron. Now, you don't have to use an iron this small. And if you don't have a little tiny craft iron like this, don't worry about it. You can use a regular iron. Just, once again, follow all of the manufacturer's instructions on ironing on any type of decal. Now, while that's heating, I just want to show you some other designs, or iron-ons. And you can go crazy. I mean, you can do stuff like this. You can do studs, very hot right now. On something larger, like on a hat, you could do something really cool like that. Okay, just put this on just like that. And then what you want to do is let that cool for just a second. And then you're just going to peel this off.
Voila! And you end up with a design just like that. Now on this one, I went ahead and added some extra embellishments, if you will. These are sew-on rhinestones. They have the little holes already drilled into them. I prefer to do that rather than gluing because they're large and chances are they're just going to get knocked off anyway. So if you stitch them on, you'll be rest assured that they won't come off. And I also had some extra little bling laying around. I mean, you can use any kind of beading you have, any kind of rhinestone that you have. You can add ribbon. But again, because this part gets stretched a lot, I would just make sure that it's something that you can stitch on and not glue on. And that way, girlfriends, ooh yeah, you'll be nice and warm and styling.
Super Simple with Terri O was made possible by
Goodwill of Central Arizona uses retail store revenue to support the community with employment and human services programs that train and prepare individuals for work and finding jobs. Good stuff, good work, Goodwill. Information at goodwillaz.org.
To Fix It is a Valley-based referral service providing a resource for pre-screened, hand-selected companies who are chosen from hundreds of companies. We recommend the best and toss the rest. Information at tofixit.com or 602-TO-FIX-IT.
Gilbert Ortega Galleries features authentic, handmade Native American art, jewelry, and crafts. Fifth generation family-owned and operated. Locations in Old Town Scottsdale and Fifth Avenue. Experience what we have spent a lifetime learning.
More tips and videos are available online at azpbs.org/Terri O.